Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel, Nursing with Beatrice. I am Beatrice and today we'll be looking at the topic deep vein thrombosis, or we call it DVT. So deep vein thrombosis is a disease condition where there is formation of blood clot in the deep veins. For us to better understand this topic, let's just recap, let's take our mind back to how blood flow or circulate in the heart. And let's remember that we have arteries and we have veins. Those days, if we used to remember, we say arteries start with A, meaning a way, right? So we say arteries are blood vessels that carry oxygenated blood away from the heart. And we say vein, we do the opposite. Veins carry deoxygenated blood towards the heart. That doesn't mean we will not remember that there's an exception to this. For instance, even if the arteries carry oxygenated blood away from the heart, we have the pulmonary artery that do the opposite. They carry deoxygenated blood towards the heart. And then we have the veins. They are doing the opposite of the artery, like I said. They are carrying what? Deoxygenated blood towards the heart, except the pulmonary veins, which carry oxygenated blood away from the heart. So I'll try to, if you look at this diagram, I try to differentiate it with two colors. This right side showing blue is showing deoxygenated blood. The left side with red is showing that the blood is oxygenated. So usually, blood that is coming from the upper extremities, from the head, from the hands, are emptied into the right atrium through the what, superior vena cava. And blood coming from the lower extremities are emptied into the what, right atrium again through the inferior vena cava. Now, when this blood gets in here, we're not looking at the conduction activities that happen in the heart at this time, but we know that when those electrical conduction happens and all these discharges occur, the blood is pushed down through this right atrioventricular valve, which is what we call tricuspid valve. The blood enters into the right ventricle. When it gets into the right ventricle, the heart contracts and the blood pushes through this pulmonary valve into the lungs for oxygenation, for the lungs to give oxygen, to add oxygen to the blood. Once oxygen has been added to the blood becomes red. It's returned back to the left atrium through the pulmonary veins. When it gets to this left atrium, the blood is pushed down through this left atrioventricular valve, what we call bicuspid valve, into the left ventricle. When the blood gets to the left ventricle, the heart also contracts and the blood pushes into the aorta. Some part of it are supplying the head and then and the hands, and others go straight to the whole body. That is how the circulation continues. Now, let's look at the pathophysiology of deep vein thrombosis. What will make a blood clot? What will make blood clot to happen or to occur in the deep veins? Now, basically, it starts at times with endothelial injury. So the endothelium, the lining of the blood vessel, if it's injured, maybe for example, you are trying to put in an IV line and you puncture the vein, that will occur and then something and blood was just, injury has occurred there. And this could cause narrowing of the blood vessels, and which will also lead to what we call vasoconstriction. Also, it could be as a result of stasis. You know, because of that vasoconstriction and blood is not moving well, the blood can be slowed down and then the clot eventually forms. And this clot, when it forms, it can be dangerous if it breaks off. If it breaks off, we call it embolus. That's the blood clot is in motion. If it goes through the pulmonary circulation, it goes to the lungs, it can cause what we call pulmonary embolism. That is dangerous, an emergency, because it can lead to death. Now, in some disease condition, like people that have some heart valve issues, where there's an opening, like all this atrial septal defect, where blood is able to shunt from the right side to the left side, for example. So if the blood, for instance, moves and shunts from the left, from the right atrium, is shunt straight to the left atrium, it then to the left ventricle, and then enter the aorta, and then moves to the head, for example, and then get to the brain. It can cause what we call embolic stroke. So DVT is a disease condition where, though it can be managed easily, like you can control it, but if the clot breaks off, it can be dangerous. We'll look more when we look at Virchow triad, how this whole thing happened, the contributors, what can cause blood clot to form. Let's look at the causes of deep vein thrombosis, or what are the factors that can lead to clot formation in the deep veins. I put this slash risk factors because when we look at the three main factors, under it we'll be having some factors, risk factors that will predispose the patient to those clot formation. So we have three main factors. These three main factors, we call it Virchow triad. See, Virchow triad. Triad means three. So there are three main factors that can lead to formation of that blood clot. One is endothelial injury. Two is hypercoagulation. Three is stasis. Let's look at it more in details. So endothelial injury. The endothelium is that inner lining of the blood vessel. When it is injured due to some of these things here listed, patient could develop blood clot. How would this happen? For example, in patients that smoke, people that smoke, the toxin from tobacco could damage the endothelium. Infection is another one that can damage the endothelium. In an inflammatory condition, the endothelium can be damaged. And then in venae puncture, IV cannulation, you are trying to put an IV line for a patient, and you know the IV line, of course, you are trying severally, and you are puncturing the vein itself. And then blood clot could just form from there. And then central venous devices, where they put in central catheters and all that, because of the process, the procedure in putting those catheters, the endothelium could be injured. In hypercoagulation, where the blood become clot easily, you know, so we say hypercoagulation. Coagulation has to do with clotting, hyper over clotting, so clotting happens more. What are conditions that put a patient in this hypercoagulation state? We have surgery, especially cesarean section, abdominal surgery, hip surgery, like hip replacement, knee replacement surgery. This puts a patient at risk of hypercoagulation, where the blood can clot easily. Medication, like birth control, because of estrogen, the patient could be in this state of hypercoagulation. Cancer is a big one that can put a patient at risk of hypercoagulation. Postpartum, when a woman has delivered, especially when a woman had a baby through cesarean section, most times they put the woman on anticoagulant like low molecular weight heparin, like dalteparin, maybe for 5 days or so, just to help the patient, you know, to reduce the risk of what, clot formation. In dehydration, when the blood is dehydrated, when somebody is dehydrated, the blood becomes more thick, so there's increased viscosity of the blood, and of course, clot can easily form. We look at stasis. Stasis means something that is either not moving or just slow, where the blood is moving very slow. What are some conditions that can put a patient at this state? Inactivity. You are living a sedentary lifestyle. You are not really doing exercise. You are not moving. You're just on one spot. You are at risk of what stasis. The blood will become what, slow, and that clots can resolve from there. Some of this inactivity can be from flight, long flight. You travel 10 hours. 20 hours, you're on a flight, you are not moving. So the person can be at risk for clot formation because of stasis. Car trips, where you travel for 2 days, 3 days journey, even a day journey, because you are just on one spot, you are not really moving like that. And then hospitalization for patients that are sick and they are on bed rest, or even if they are not on bed rest, but at least they are in the hospital, they don't have that liberty, the privilege to move around, to go to their houses, go to friends' places and all that. So that's why when a patient is in the hospital, we encourage them to do some exercises. we make sure that they get up for their meals, they walk around, the, you know, when they're able to move around as soon as possible. We don't want them to just remain on that spot where they cannot develop what stasis. And that's why in the hospital too, when a patient is on prolonged hospitalization, they still put some of those patients on medication. The doctors may just prescribe a medication like anticoagulant, like all those heparin, dapirolizumab and all that, just to help to reduce that risk of blood formation or clot formation. In pregnancy, which we also looked at in hypercoagulation. So what happened, a baby, the fetus that is forming, they could compress the veins around where the, around that region, and the woman can be in this state of stasis where the blood is not moving much. And then, of course, we've mentioned surgery, varicose veins, where those veins have been stretched and they are stretched to a point where the blood is no longer moving freely. In atrial fibrillation, the patient can be experience a stasis could occur. And in heart failure, like left ventricular heart failure. So the patient, the blood can be very slow, it's not moving and all that, and clot could form from there. So we look at the signs and symptoms of deep vein thrombosis. Just take note, in most cases, one leg is affected. This kind of differentiates from peripheral venous insufficiency. We'll look at that in another topic. So one leg in most cases is affected in DVT. So when you look at the leg, you could easily see the difference. One leg is, you know, swollen, big, red, warm to touch. The other leg is normal. So it's kind of easy to differentiate. So some of the signs and symptoms are basically symptoms of inflammation. What are the symptoms of inflammation? The patient will experience pain, redness, and warm. The area when you touch it is warm to touch. And then swelling, of course, is because of inflammation, swelling will be there. So that's why I said when you see, look at the leg, you compare. Let's say it's the right leg that is affected. That right leg will be swollen, will be warm to touch, will be, you know, the patient will be feeling pain there. And then you see it and compare it with the other leg, which looked normal. You can begin to think as a nurse, think critically that this patient could be worth having DVT, which they will confirm with other tests and all that. Now for you, for NCLEX purpose, for your nursing school exam, you need to know what is Hormann sign. So this Hormann sign is just like a test you do to test, you know, to kind of at least see, to see if they, just to test for DVT. So what we do, we tell the patient to lie flat. The particular leg that is affected, you tell them to dorsiflex it. Most times you do it for them because they are already feeling pain. They may not be able to do it. So you do it for them. So you kind of dorsiflex. To dorsiflex means you are doing it this way. Dorsiflexion, right? So the leg that is affected, you dorsiflex toward the shin of the leg. And when you do that, the patient is going to feel pain. That confirms Hormann sign. So take note of that for NCLEX purpose or for your nursing school exam. Now, part of the signs and symptoms, before you start seeing shortness of breath, chest pain, and even death, which is the last, we don't want that to happen to any patient, is when the blood clots, you know, when the clots that had dislodged, when we're looking at the pathophysiology, we say that when the blood clots, breaks and become an embolus and it moves, if it goes into the pulmonary circulation, it could cause what we call pulmonary embolism. Pulmonary embolism, very dangerous, it's life-threatening. So if this happens, pulmonary embolism occur, the patient could be experiencing shortness of breath because the clot has gone into the pulmonary circulation. Shortness of breath, patient could be feeling chest pain. And if it's not managed, death could occur. So we don't want it to get to that state, but take note that DVT can lead to pulmonary embolism. And that's why we'll look at it shortly in management of DVT. If the clot is present already there, like you, the clot is confirmed through test, we make sure the patient is on bed rest until that clot is taken care of. So because we don't want that clot to dislodge, we'll discuss that more now. Then let's look at how they diagnose DVT. So to diagnose DVT, basically, they use some test procedure, like the scan procedure, Doppler scan. They do an ultrasound to see if they could locate that blood clot. Then they could do D-dimer test. So edema is just a protein fragment the body makes when blood clot breaks down. So that they want to check to see if it is high. And then venography, that's a more confirmatory method if the Doppler is able to detect the blood clot. So they just inject a dye through the vein and take an X-ray just to see the picture and see the location of the blood clot. Then that will move us to the treatment and management, nursing intervention for DVT. So for the treatment, at times the clot could resolve on its own if it's a small clot. The body could just help, you know, the clot will just break down. But in some cases, the clot may not, because the clot could become very big. It may require some medication. We call it thrombolytics. So the primary healthcare provider will prescribe thrombolytics to break, when you say thrombolytics, it breaks down the thrombus, it breaks down that blood clot. While the patient is yet to be given the thrombolytics, the patient is on bed rest, because we don't want that clot, like I said earlier, to break off and go to the pulmonary circulation and cause pulmonary embolism, which can be life-threatening. We don't want that. So when the diagnostic procedure have confirmed the presence of active blood clot, we put them on bed rest, then the primary care provider prescribe thrombolytics to break down the clot. So if it's not effective, they may do surgery, they may do what we call thrombectomy. So where they go in and cut off, not to remove that blood clot. So while they're on bed rest, we encourage the patient, they should not massage the side, they should not massage that leg, because they may be feeling, you know, that because of that pain, and they may want to, you know, they will tell them, don't massage it, just leave it the way it is. And then how do we prevent DVT? So the prevention, the treatment I've mentioned is why the thing is happening, why there's an active blood clot. But our emphasis more is on prevention. We don't even want it to happen in the first place. So exercise. So when you are on a long flight, you're traveling, you can exercise your calf muscle. You can just move your leg, stand up, go to the washroom, come back. You know, just try and make sure you are doing something with those legs. You are not staying on one spot. And then the use of anticoagulant. This one, you are not to just prescribe it for yourself. Your healthcare provider will prescribe. It could prescribe heparin, warfarin, all those medications, even low-dose aspirin, could be prescribed, especially if you've ever experienced DVT before, or you are even at risk of experiencing DVT, like a woman that just has a cesarean section. And then after delivery, they don't want the woman, because the woman is already in a state of hypercoagulation. The healthcare provider could just prescribe low molecular weight heparin, like that heparin, and say, take it for 5 days, take it for 7 days, just to prevent that. So, and then the use of compression devices, even compression studies, compression that subconscious compression device, will ensure that when the patient is on knees, it should be continuously plugged. And when the patient is on lying down or sitting, the patient should be on knees. And when the patient is walking, that's when we say, okay, you can remove it. And we care for it if you see at times, because they stay in one spot, it could be smelling, it could be wet, it could be maybe the patient maybe had a bowel movement and while they are changing, and then something, one way or the other, they are doing a sponge bath for the patient or bed bath and the place is wet and all that. So we change it regularly. We change it, we ensure it is plugged, we take care of it. And then compression stockings are also one. We encourage the patient to wear it, especially when they are on bed rest, like they're on hospitalization. Like I said earlier, when they're on bed rest where the blood clot is still active, we don't ask them to move. They are in one spot until that clot breaks. But once that clot is broken, we ask them to start exercising. But for a patient that doesn't have DVT at all in the first place, but they are in a state of it, they are at risk of having it, where we have mentioned some of those cases, like the woman that have had a baby, we encourage them to start moving immediately. They did surgery, immediately they start recovering. We are already telling them, you know, to start working. We start involving the OTPT for them to start being active. We don't want them to just stay in that spot. They came for one treatment and then they are leaving the hospital with a bigger problem. We don't want that. So we encourage exercise. So that wraps up the topic for today. If you enjoyed this topic, please like, share, and subscribe for more educational content. Thank you.